to our panelists, I'm going to start by asking my good friend Julio to give just a real brief self-introduction. We'll run down the line and then we'll get into some questions. So, Julio.
Thank you very much, Jarad. I am just delighted to be here. Thank you, Global Institute. Thank you for your leadership, and thank you, IATA, for hosting us. I work at Carbon Direct. Carbon Direct is an end-to-end carbon services company. End-to-end carbon services company. This is something new on God's green earth, and we're very eager to be able to do that. We do a lot of work in the voluntary carbon market. We advise companies on how to purchase valid, durable CO2 removals of all kinds, how to assess and diligence these emerging technology sectors that are so difficult, how to navigate the complex world of policy, how to develop corporate strategies, and all these things, but very much so. We also have an investment arm of our company that puts money to work in new companies, including CO2 renewable companies, clean fuels, CO2 products, and conventional carbon capture. I've spent 30 years working on climate, 20 years working on carbon management, 12 years working on CO2 removal. I've worked in government, industry, and academia, and I'm glad to talk to you today.
Hello, good afternoon. My name is Edward Renaud. I'm from Cleaner Task Force. We are an international climate nonprofit, very much focused on accelerating clean energy and innovation technologies we're going to need for a net zero energy system. We very much focus on other sort of topics as well related to hydrogen, carbon capture, storage. Carbon removals is very much a topic which we've grown to understand that in the last several years that it's going to be essential if we're going to reach net zero and net negative afterwards. We're very much focused on policy advocacy, so we engage the United States and European levels as well, trying to understand from a better analytical point of view what are the real key policies we need in order to accelerate these technologies and these processes, and how best can we develop a global energy system that takes into better account other than just simple economics, but also social factors and political factors too. Very much thank you for joining.
Hi everybody, I'm Eli Mitchell-Larson. I'm the co-founder of Carbon Gap. We're a relatively new NGO. We launched last COP. We're focused exclusively on advocating for removals and policies that can bring about just and effective carbon removals in Europe. That means we span both the engineered solutions that we'll be talking about today and also all the other solutions. And I think we'll also get into today that question of what is that distinction, or is there one, between engineered and non-engineered methods. About me, I'm a geochemist by training, so it's exciting to get back into the topic of turning molecules into rock. I spent some time in the solar and wind industry, so I think it'll be great to talk today about how the lessons about project finance to scale up carbon removal we can draw on from the previous clean energy revolution. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Also, thank you for the invitation. My name is Steve Kelly. I'm president of 1.5 International. Chemical engineer by background. I'm pretty new to the climate space. I spent all my career in oil and gas, upstream assets, and major project plant development. I've been with Oxy for 27 years, recently moved over to Oxy for carbon ventures. So 1.5 is the planning deployment arm of OICB, and what we are doing is we're deploying carbon engineering's technologies. Carbon engineering is the technology company based out of British Columbia, and we are the global deployment partner. We've started construction of the first plant in the US, and my job is to try to get projects off the ground outside of the United States, in Europe, and East Asia.
Great. Well, I think this is going to make my job easier to get. Hopefully you guys are already starting to think about the questions. We've got folks that have expertise in government, policy making, and industry,
Sure. So there's three big things we need, and people put these in different orders, but that's okay. Money, people, infrastructure. We don't have the capital stack. We need to do this in a real way. The voluntary carbon market is neither large enough nor priced highly enough to deliver engineered pathways for most of these pathways. Infrastructure. We do not have holes in the ground. We do not have pipelines. We do not have green power corridors. We don't have these things in the way that we need them to scale the projects we need. The one that keeps me up at night, though, is the people. It's not just a question of do we have scientists and engineers. We kind of have enough scientists and engineers. We can probably make more. We do not have agency staff to permit this. We do not have specialty welders and electricians to build these projects. We do not have tax equity lawyers who know anything about this space, so they can't put together a real deal, with the exception of JP over there, who's feeling hurt. He knows how to do it, but that's my point. If he gets hit by a bus, we've lost 50% of the global capacity in this space. We don't have enough human capital. We don't have curricula. We don't have boot camps. We don't have internships or fellowships or externships or short courses or master classes. We simply don't have the people to pull this off to go to the gigaton scale. We could retrain people, but they are absent today.
Anyone else want us to go down the line or hop for it?
It is free form. This is meant to be a conversation. Whoever wants to take the mic.
I think that was excellent. I would add one more, which is somewhat related to the human capital piece, which is public acceptability. And by that I mean humanizing some of the engineered carbon removal solutions, right? Because I heard recently, this is sort of a riff on something Julio has said, someone was saying, you know, we'll know we'll have succeeded as a kind of carbon removal community when more of the people working in carbon removal have, you know, steel-toed boots and hard hats than all of us typing away on our computers. So that's kind of, in order to get to that point, we need people to see carbon removal in that way. And I think often, because of all of the, you know, rightful anger, I think, that exists around, you know, how some of the historical fossil fuel infrastructure and heavy industry has been cited, the environmental justice issues of that, people kind of apply those same fears and concerns to other big infrastructure that at the end of the day is making the atmosphere safer. So it's a process of education and exposure to show communities. I think Carbfix in Iceland is a good example of having done that outreach and done that work. Also the US DAC hub provision, where I think some significant portion of the benefits of that policy must go to local communities. So people are starting to see that. But I think, you know, most people outside of this room and whoever's watching the recording don't know what engineered carbon removal looks like. They haven't seen an isotainer on a truck drive to a train and then continue on to Rotterdam and go to Iceland. That's the Demo Up Karma project. I recommend checking it out. So that would be my addition. Anyone else?
Yes, so I completely agree with everything that's been said. And what we're trying to do is address that challenge by getting started. You know, this is all about getting to scale. So we're putting boots on the ground now. We've got construction started on the first megaton scale plant being built in Texas. So we've moved ahead. There's still a lot of things that need to happen in parallel in terms of MRV certification. Voluntary market where it's capable of supporting the initial wave projects. And we're not standing.
work. You've already heard, right? You need a business agent to know how to do this, and we need this to be part of the conversation. Okay, and hope, can people in the back hear me okay? All right, okay. So, with that sort of as a nice segue, we add another layer to the conversation, and we can give you and give our maybe have the next response. In addition to what we just heard in terms of what we all need to do collectively together, what are the key issues that need to be resolved from a global governance perspective around this engineer?
Yeah, thanks. I think really like what insights from Steve there were very helpful in terms of what is needed to get projects off the ground. But ultimately, we really need to actually assess, you know, we know we need carbon removal. We know we need a lot of carbon removal. We don't know exactly kind of what the new responsibility is actually going to be. In the European Union, for example, there's an ongoing debate in terms of now we're beginning to see, you know, we're going to need carbon removal occurring at several million tons per year scale by 2050 when we reach climate neutrality, and we're going to need a lot more of it when we go to try to be net negative afterwards. But implicit within sort of negotiating in terms of how we reduce our emissions, there's a real questions that need to be answered in terms of do we set separate emission reduction targets, who is actually responsible for this. I think on a global level, there's certainly a lot more going on currently regarding Article 6, and I think Eva is probably the best person on the panel to speak about that. But I definitely think that in terms of breaking down even the national and the regional level, we don't actually know whose responsibility it is to do carbon removal. And then further to that, you know, what policies do we need to achieve all of those things that Julio mentioned, you know, infrastructure, people, funding. In Europe, for example, we're only now beginning to start with a regulatory framework for carbon removals. So before we actually start handing out millions of dollars for funding and subsidies, we need to actually, you know, have a way of measuring and reporting and monitoring, reporting and verifying when is a ton of CO2 actually removed. And that's very much sort of one of the key building blocks. But I think ultimately when it comes to the governance aspect, I definitely see a role for governments, but also for the private sector involved in this. We're very much beginning to sort of look at who is actually going to be responsible for CO2. We don't really know yet.
So building on Edward's point, but also going back to your question, what are the needs? I think one of the needs is still, and sometimes we forget about it because we are operating in this bubble where we talk to people who all know about renewables, they know about these renewables. There are still plenty of important people, like decision makers, policy makers, that haven't really internalized what it means in practice. And if we don't have really everyone on the board, we don't end up with a clear governance system where countries will actually have specific targets for renewables that will then to scale up everything else that they need. This is kind of the starting point. Of course, you know, the corporates and it's so great what is already happening. And there are some countries that are doing so much, but we need all the countries looking into this because in the end, everyone will need to scale up renewables, right? I mean, a good example is, for example, the conversations that are currently happening here under Article 6.4. where the supervisory body was considering their recommendations on renewables during their session before COP, and now the result of that work has kind of, you know, looks to be being pushed back because there still wasn't enough time to discuss all the complexities, and some of them said openly that this was by far the most complex topic they have ever had to engage on, the most complex and most technical one. So we really, really need to help the policy with all the knowledge and information and details about successful projects and technologies to get there.
Policymakers supported by all the appropriate data, knowledge, and information sounds like a good path forward. I think Julio wants to comment, and then you might show you some back.
Right, so to build on that exactly, in order for the governance and the government bodies to really feel good about this, they need scientific standards, which they do not have today. And I look forward to the day when Oliver is less busy and he can start developing some of those in concert with other scientists around the world. This is not a question of just transparency or financial markets. There's hard technical facts and questions at the core of these issues. And without those, governments will always feel nervous passing laws and statutes into this arena. So there's a role for the scientific community in the near term to really collaborate on these standards. I want to talk about one specific area which is of high urgency for this in terms of a global governance collaboration, that's actually ocean-based CO2 removal. In addition to the very tough technical questions out there like surface mixing rates and how that affects uptake of CO2, there's an actual proper legal governance question around the London Convention of the Sea. And that just needs to be amended in a very real way. Today, almost anything that you would want to do that is large-scale CO2 removal in the oceans could be interpreted as dumping, which is prevented by the convention. So you need to get some lawyers in there and wordsmith a little bit to figure out a better option.
Yeah, I think one other point to add there is, you know, carbon removal is uniquely global, right? CO2 is so well mixed that taking CO2 out of the air anywhere is pretty much as good as taking it out anywhere else. And so it sort of necessitates this multilateral cooperation to solve the transporter conundrum of extraction, conversion, storage happening in three different countries. How do you work out the accounting? Eva touched on that. But another area is on the scientific gaps. So Carbon Plan put out this really excellent work around verification confidence levels. We call it certainty of carbon benefit, which is much less catchy. But what we're saying is, you know, we have some confidence as to what carbon, the level of confidence we have in the carbon benefit that has been delivered. And we have uncertainties around that. And the magnitude of those uncertainties is dependent on certain fundamental basic science gaps. Now, we only have, you know, 27 years here, so we can't let basic science take its normal course and figure out what volatile organic compounds, what warming impact they have, or, you know, various elements of ocean optimization and how that migrates through the water, through the thermohaline circulation, or what have you. So we need to, and actually there's some really exciting work coming out, I think in the next couple weeks, through RMI and Frontier, which will try to start cataloging what those scientific gaps are, ranking them according to how much, if they were resolved, the uncertainty would shrink. Then we could send dedicated research funds, we could build, I think they call them focused research organizations, entities that just go after a scientific question like nothing else, answer it, and then propagate that through all these different markets. And, you know, as Eric touched on, this is pressing. Policymakers are, in a way, coming to this issue maybe slightly before we might like, or we might be ready for them. The European Union is about to release on November 30th a proposal for a carbon removal certification framework. This could be the first kind of supranational certification system, and they're going to be asking, what are the methodologies? The US Department of Energy, same thing. The UK Department of Business and Environmental Strategy. So we have to answer these questions quickly because policymakers, without having the capacity or understanding, are asking us, okay, what do we do? How do we measure this stuff?
Well, and I think it's a fascinating conversation, right? Like from my perspective, globally, you know, all of these various sectors and groups have a role to play, right? Government has to put together durable, lasting, strategic policies based on sound science, right? We need this government at a local scale, at a regional scale, at a global scale. Industry is going to need to find mechanisms to build on and operate this, right, and make an appropriate return. The financial community is going to need to find markets and investment opportunities, again, and make academia is going to need to continue to advance the technology and the scientific understanding and help on the human capital that Julio mentioned at the start, right? And so part of all of these pieces fitting together is that marketplace, right, where from a business case scenario, this can scale. And so maybe pulling on this thread a little bit, maybe a follow-up question, how do the folks on the panel see the interplay between voluntary markets and carbon offsetting and the path forward to scale CBR?
Steve, if you'd like to go first, that's fine.
Just to make the case, the point that we're very dependent on the voluntary market today, but the underpinning of the revenue stack with 45 kilo tax credit, and we build on that with a pretty lively voluntary market, but a scale, we need compliance market to capture. That's where we see the interplay is that the voluntary market provides us with the revenue for the first of kind plants and the first generation of multiple plants. But at some point, the compliance market needs to catch up and take over.
Right, so really we need to see a long-term shift from voluntary markets into compliance markets. That's the main game. So for example, the CORSIA standards are going to become mandatory in 2027. It is unclear if any of the pathways we're talking about are going to be a compliance mechanism in that market. But if they were, then that would actually automatically charge the industry in a very real way. products in the voluntary carbon market today. And you don't need to look very hard to find that. Our own published work is that 97.5% of what is in the market is not valid, durable, removable. Something else. That matches Microsoft's numbers, which are 97.3%. That's within the range of Bloomberg's numbers, which is 95%. 95 to 97.5% is not valid, durable, removable. That is what the engineer pathways get you. But until you actually have a high enough price, certainty of standards, all these other sorts of things we've been talking about, I love the VCM. We spend a lot of time at the VCM, but it's hard to see that really delivering a multi-billion-dollar project right now. We just need additional compliance options and money.
Yeah, and it's interesting, right? Because there's a variety of carbon dioxide offsets that are available in the voluntary markets, and one of the benefits of the engineered CDR is the geologic timescale storage and the permanence, right? And the folks that I talk to in the finance sector say we are willing to value that appropriately, right? But it's interesting that those markets debalance in them would be in everybody's best interest, right? And again, room for everybody to put them forward here. One of these questions, and maybe you can rely on this, and then I've got a follow-up in terms of, from your perspective, what's an appropriate public role for all of this?
In a way, yeah, I'm touching the public growth. So very conveniently, just today, a new report from the Global CCS that I helped go together with NASDAQ. So NASDAQ is a majority stakeholder at Jarad.org's carbon removal marketplace. And what I'm looking at specifically is how to tackle the situation where you have durable, like engineered carbon removal projects that do receive some public funding, but that public funding might not be enough to actually make the project viable. And then the projects are looking at voluntary carbon markets, and for a good reason, because they're just not yet included within the compliance market. So voluntary markets is just like the other tool, that's the only tool that they have available to drive the financing. But if you look at these two things coming together, you run into so many different levels of complexities. First question is, if there is some public funding involved, is it even possible to issue voluntary market credits for the project? So what do the standards say? That's the first question, and that will, to some extent, depend on the standard, right? Then the next level question is, does the government have any specific regulation in place from their own side? Because obviously, every country is free to regulate how do they want to, what kind of safeguards or rules they want to put in place for the projects that are using voluntary market credits, whether they require some kind of registration, whether they require some kind of fees, whether they want to link in any way the financing that is raised to the voluntary market credits with the public funding, and maybe get some of the funding back. So countries are actually taking very, very different approaches to that, because in the US, you can easily combine 45Q cash credits and voluntary market credits, right? For example, then in Norway, it seems to be a very different approach, where at least for one project, the plan is that if the project actually sells credits to the voluntary markets, then it would need to pay back proportionally to the public funding to the government, so the share that it has received in the public funding, and they can just profit the difference. And we can see even like different and different models being built up in different countries, which is, again, we will have to live in this kind of patchwork of different solutions. And then the last and most complex consideration of all is when it all comes to the Article 6 of the Paris Agreement, and what kind of claims can actually be made if a project is very clearly contributing to the country's NDC, but then also wants to claim voluntary market credits against its own corporate climate targets. And again, there are different points of views, different options how to tackle it. There might be interesting options to build the corporate climate targets in a way very transparently can actually use credits that contribute to the country's targets, but as you are operating within the country's target, you also use such credits towards your own corporate climate target. But that really depends based on which rules you have set your corporate targets. So it's just we are operating currently in this space that has so much fragmentation, and partly because the Paris Agreement is a bottom-up process and every country can just put in place their own rules. But for now, I think for the foreseeable future, I can see that those countries that have put in place the very clear rules up front will be the ones who benefit most from such funding.
Yeah, defragmenting public policy globally, critical, right? And having public policy expressed and well communicated in a durable fashion up front, absolutely critical. I know Julio has some thoughts, and I think he's got a broad. Julio and I worked at DOE together, and I know he has some public policy thoughts and works with them, maybe do work.
Thank you, and I do apologize. I have another CO2 renewable panel that I have to join in just about 5 minutes, so I'll be skipping around from here to another pavilion. So we are very much in a place which is new in this whole topic. The IPCC report that came out earlier this year stuck the discount on the science. We just know we have to do this now at enormous volume and with enormous speed. And we have to figure out how to cooperate in a way which is completely new, extremely broad, and must cut across sectors and cultures in a way that is brand new to this. So there's only one word that I want to leave all of you with in this on my way out the door so that you can then listen to this extraordinary panel some more. The one word I want to leave you with is generosity. Ultimately, CO2 removal is an act of generosity. You're saying, I'm going to clean up my mess. I'm going to do it on behalf of the whole world. There are going to be free riders. I'm okay with that. I'm going to pay too much money. I'm okay with that. I'm going to do it for biodiversity. I'm okay with that. It's born of generosity. And in order to get it done, we must be even more generous with each other. Because scientists have to work with market people. And they don't generally like to do that. And market people have to work with NGOs. And NGOs have to work with government and civil society. And we have to work with communications experts and agencies and all these and people in communities. And that level of generosity of spirit and time is also kind of new. It's unprecedented, but it's also irreplaceable. There is no way we will get to multi-gigaton scale removal of CO2 removal in engineered pathways or all of them or any of them without that kind of commitment from each other.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Julio. Have fun at the next panel. Thank you for your contribution here. I want to pull on the thread of that in terms of public policy. Clearly, time is not on our side. Clearly, this is a complex issue we all need to work together on. And so the engineer in me says, okay, let's find the most efficient path for it. So my follow-on question to the panel, and I know that all of you will have thoughts on this, from an efficient public policy, a public mechanism to support CDR and accelerate it to get it from where it is to that gigaton scale that all the math says we must find, right? What are your thoughts on what are those effects of public policy? Public procurement, is it support for R&D? What mix do you think would be most efficient in your perspective?
Look, I think when we start talking about efficiency, to me, most of the work that I focus on is on point source capture, and direct air capture is sort of a follow-on to that, as well as bioenergy, carbon capture and storage. To me, the sort of key synergy, the binding link between both of these sites, and we should collectively, I think, refer to them as sort of carbon management. The real thing that links both of them is infrastructure. We're talking pipelines, storage sites. You know, in the IPCC saying we need 600 billion tons cumulatively of CO2 will have to be permanently stored geologically by 2100. You know, we do have a decision to make in sort of that sense of how much are we going to reduce and abate from point sources, and how much are we going to rely on direct air capture and negative emissions to achieve that in the future. And I think implicit in sort of like the efficiency part point is that we very much need to focus on the infrastructure aspect. In Europe, for example, we have a 50 shortfall on storage capacity just for 2030 projects that have been announced, and this is regarding point source capture. So there will also be bottlenecks down the line when it comes to phasing up direct air capture, and we very much need to focus on what are the sort of key early sort of things that we need to address on the infrastructure side of things, and also the synergy between where that clean energy is going to come from, the sort of renewable clean electricity that's going to be needed for direct air capture, as well as the storage site. And then, you know, what sort of mechanisms are going to come into the play? I think the US has very much set the ball rolling in terms of 45Q, but also, you know, the CFIA, the sort of infrastructure, providing loans, providing incentives for infrastructure development. Those are definitely the things I think we focus on is what can we actually get projects in the ground going versus, you know, obviously, you know, credit trading is also very much important, but I think definitely probably, you know, what are the sort of incentives that we can get to provide infrastructure projects with the supports that we need now?
I'll just take it from here. Efficient public policy. We need clear intent from the policymakers on how much renewables and how do they intend to scale up for the policies. And then how would they do that without compromising the steep emission reductions that people need. And how the policy looks like, it will keep changing over the years. But I mean, in addition to what Everett already mentioned, we clearly have to figure out much better the accounting side of things. In the EU, as Eli mentioned, we have the carbon removal certification mechanism where we'll see the proposal towards the end of this month. And the question is, like, how does that fit into the existing policy system? How to make sure that it actually drives a difference, and we need to know that these policies are made with a clear cut in mind. For example, when it comes to this EU's CRCM, so this carbon certification mechanism, I have not fully understood the intent yet. I mean, partly it's yes, we need to get started and get going, but we keep hearing the hints, but then it could play a different role in the next decade. But I mean, we should know already now what is the pathway, what kind of role it's going to play later. Then how do we get from here to there? Because we are not designing only for the next 2 to 5 years. We are designing for much, much longer. So that's what I'm going to
say. I just want to build on something that Eva mentioned earlier, which is the question around NDCs and sale of credits. Unsurprisingly, when we engage with international governments and parties in countries outside of the US, they're very focused and very interested on what that revenue stack would look like without necessarily a costing there. And the ability to answer that question around whether or not they can contribute to their own NDCs as well as selling credits internationally. And then that links into the whole question of the Article 6 transfers and the fact that when we look at our deployment worldwide, we're really looking at a combination of high demand countries and high supply countries. Not everybody is blessed with the geologic storage that is necessary for this. And unfortunately for some people, that's the very high demand countries are among those that don't have the capability to take CO2 out of the atmosphere and store it permanently. So there has to be some cross-border transfer of credits at some point, whether it's at NDC level or at corporate level.
Eli Mitchell, please, and then keep thinking about your questions because I've got one more and then we're going to turn this over to the audience.
Right. Yeah, I just wanted to underline Eva's point about we need political will from policymakers to do this, and they need us to create that, right? There isn't right now a constituency of people, maybe farmers, in the sort of soil carbon sequestration side of CDR, but in most CDR methods, there isn't a constituency that's telling their policymaker, you need to do this. So to kind of provide not a counterpoint, but the other side of the coin that Eva presented, I think that policymakers largely are kind of playing catch-up in some ways. And we have some policymakers in the room, so I encourage you after to hit them up and ask them, you know, what do you need? But I think, you know, often on the standard side, on the engineering side, on all these things, the CDR community, or the sort of subsurface storage community, already knows a lot of this stuff. And I worry that I think we have to be opportunistic. We have to say, how can we find a way to put an incentive for engineered carbon removal into a public procurement program for concrete? Or, you know, how can we look at a low carbon fuel standard and try to make high durability carbon removal one of the means of compliance in that policy? Sometimes we won't have a plan. We won't have a clearly conceived pathway that policymakers have dreamed up, because frankly, we're still playing catch up that even carbon removal is necessary. Thank God for the Working Group Green Report from the IPCC that finally gave us a strong definition of carbon removal, reasoning why we need it in the short, medium, and long term. Without that, but that's been known for a while, right? And the point is, policymakers still haven't picked up on that. So they need to be pushed
or maybe pulled, I don't know what the right direction is, into doing this. And we have to keep our eyes open in every direction. And we can't just be myopic about any one policy framework. We have to always be looking for a way to help scale the industry we know needs to be scaled.
So when we talk about efficient policy, one thing is this very general level where we need to make sure that we build removal policies in a way that doesn't have any impact on production policies, right? So that's one element of it. But then I think it's just always important to keep it like also up there together with all the other thoughts and considerations that removals are not one thing. This is such a broad ecosystem of different things. And the same way that countries have so different emission profiles, and so their emission reduction policies look very different, the same way I'm sure we're going to start seeing different carbon removal policies, because as I think Steve already mentioned, not every country has access to geological CO2 storage in a meaningfully close distance, for example. There are going to be countries with different potentials for different types of removals, and hence the policies there will also differ.
Well, in my view, is again framing it. No matter if we're talking to the next generation of policymakers now, and we say there is no magic silver bullet, right? We need all of these solutions. We need as much mitigation as we can. We need societal efficiency on energy generation and on demand use. We need to electrify as many aspects as we can in society and do that with renewable electricity. We need point source carbon capture on those other hard to abate industries where, from a chemistry standpoint, there is no other choice. And we need a heck of a lot of carbon dioxide removal both in the natural and nature basins and in the engineer, right? All the climate math says we need to do this. I've got one final question that I've got, and then again I'm gonna pick the mic around and hopefully we can turn this into a dialogue and get some of your questions into the conversation. And the question is, given that framing, right, you often encounter the moral hazard conversation where people say, well, if you can just say you're gonna be able to clean it up and get it on scale through engineered carbon dioxide removal, isn't that a moral hazard that allows you to run as business as usual or emit more now if you say this is going to materialize and be cheaper and scalable more in the future? So with that framing, how do you, just in a succinct way, how do you think about and respond to the moral hazard question? Final question for me, and then we'll turn it over to the audience.
This is always the essential argument surrounds carbon removal in general, is sort of like, why should we reduce emissions first? I think everybody involved in the carbon removal space knows it's implicitly that, of course, we need to reduce emissions first. But so often this tends to be lost on people new to the space, and particularly the environmental movement. The way in which I think about this very much so is that, look, we need to store gigatons of CO2 permanently by 2050 and beyond. We can decide how we want to do that. Do we want to take it from point sources? Do we want to take it from direct air capture? But either way, we're going to need to do it. So I very much focus on the infrastructure side of things. I definitely think direct air capture and other forms of carbon capture are going to need to reduce their costs on the capture side. But certainly when we're thinking about infrastructure, that's the way in which it has to be framed. That if you want to see emissions come down through reductions as well as through removals, we need to very much focus on building up the storage aspect. And I think that's very much particularly related for engineers doing carbon removals. I think for land-based removals, that's beyond the scope of the session, I do think there's a massive question to be asked in terms of where permanence is going to be, and if you think it's going to be necessary to build to scale up as much removals on land and on the oceans as possible. But certainly when we're looking at engineered removals, I definitely think that the building up storage space is going to be key, both in the near term, the medium term, and the long term. And I don't think that any of these infrastructure projects are going to be stranded assets if we want to actually achieve our land goals.
Quick one to build on that. I think one thing we try to do at Carbon Gap, and I would challenge everyone to do this, is never again have a conversation about mitigation deterrence and moral hazard that is at that kind of simplistic level we're used to having, which is, yes, there is mitigation deterrence. No, there isn't, right? Because I think what we need to do in order to foster more cooperation with members of the environmental movement who do have these very legitimate concerns about mitigation deterrence is engage with them and ask them, we agree there is a risk of mitigation deterrence from removals. So let's have a discussion about what conditions, what principles, what facts would you need to see to be confident that in fact mitigation deterrence did not occur. If you're willing to have that conversation, and we think great, we have a report coming out tomorrow where we look at how much money is each company making in dollars per ton of CO2 terms. When you rank companies on that metric, you suddenly see how much are they making in the same units that we use to measure the cost of carbon removal and emission reduction. These two things communicate. To Everett's point about the fact that some, you know, less expensive removal options could more directly cause a mitigation deterrence, it is this price comparison point. And so it is possible, it is definitely possible for us to work with the folks who are very concerned about mitigation deterrence. I'm concerned about mitigation deterrence, but I'm not willing to have that very surface level conversation that says, because it would be easy for us to get up here and say, the greater moral hazard is not developing engineered carbon removal, which I believe. But that's not going to resonate with the folks that have these legitimate concerns. So let's actually engage in that conversation. Let's come up together with a list of rules. After you've done this, after you've done all your abatement under this cost, after you've shown that you're only compensating for expensive to abate emissions, then you can use engineered carbon removals as a means of compensation. Simple.
When I hear this question of moral hazard, I mean, obviously the concern is there, and as you know, this is a legitimate concern, but policymakers have all the tools at their hands, and they know how to design policies to get the outcomes they need. We have decades of experience of designing emission reduction policies. We can take all that learning and then add to that these different considerations that need to be added to design effective carbon removal policies in a way that is more how the other question is very clearly addressed. So I think that the knowledge is there, the expertise is there if needed. We should just also have a bit more trust in the policymakers that if there is a political will, we will have policies that very clearly address this problem, because I have not heard a policymaker who says that, oh, moral hazard, that's a non-issue. All of them are concerned about it. And these people know exactly how to design policies. I mean, I can say it as someone who has done it for 15 years. So have some trust also in the policymakers. It is possible. Of course, we always have uncertainties. There are different stakeholders pushing different issues and so on. But it can be done.
Our reliance is on the policymakers to answer the question. As a plant developer, I can see the size of the house here, for example. Any scenario involves several gigatons of CO2 in 2050. We cannot drop a solution on the planet in 2045 and implement 10 gigatons of carbon dioxide emissions in the last few years. We have to start now. We've announced an ambitious plan, set to plants by 2035, which we recently increased to 100 plants. It's 100 million tons a year. It's still only scratching the surface of 10 million tons. So we have to get started, we have to de-risk, we have to get cost down. We have to start now.
And just as a data point, my EA receives their net zero emissions report right about a month ago. Their figure of error is 1.9 gigaton of carbon dioxide removal by 2050, and the 18 scenarios of the IPCC have recently come out with span from 3.5 gigaton up to a little over 16 gigaton. Right? So we are clearly, all the math, all the modeling suggests this needs to scale to multiple gigatons to meet our net zero goals. So with this, hopefully as a warm up, hopefully you've been having time to think of some questions. We've got one right back here. We've got plenty of questions. And the way this is going to work is we'll just go through all the questions, have good dialogue, and save a couple of minutes at the end for a final 30-second quick thoughts or our panelists. So please, start us off.
Yes. Hi, David Cummings with Blue Sky Maritime Coalition. We are looking at getting to net zero emissions in the U.S. and Canada. The maritime is a crisis great guy. Can you hear me okay? One of the most interesting presentations that I've heard, where we're a group that innovates from everybody across public sector, private sector, NGOs, academia, transform that into synthetic diesel, heavy diesel production, or to aviation fuel. So effectively make a fuel that fits in today's infrastructure, today's pipelines, today's vessels, today's tanks, that is net negative. To what extent are you looking at that in terms of carbon capture? Or, and I understand that technology exists today and can be made operational in 8 years. And 5 of those 8 years are permitting. So we treat this as a global pandemic, which climate change is a global pandemic. We know that we can shortcut permitting and get this done before 2030.
The question, synthetic fuels, can you start us off?
It's very much part of the future. So we focused in this discussion so far on credits and renewables, and that's obviously really, really important, but there's another use for CO2 that's extracted from the atmosphere, and that is synthetics. It's also products, just, you know, there's a whole array of products in development where there's some fantastic uses, both for permanent storage in building materials and so on, as well as fuels, which create a circular loop of carbon. And we're very engaged in that as a potential use of the CO2 from the plants that we've developed as well.
And for all of these questions, right, I think it's important to take a step back and say, from a systems perspective, from a life cycle analysis perspective, does this scheme or does this approach give us net durable emission reductions, right? That's always a very good lens to look at. Anybody else want to add anything to that question, or should we get a next question? All right, Mike, please, go ahead.
So, first, I just want to say thank you, Eli, because I've been as guilty as anybody here. Moral hazard question, not engaging with it in a helpful way, sort of like, oh, that's like saying to having an oncologist you're just smoking, sort of response to that. That's just like a dumb Twitter dunking on your competition response that doesn't get to anywhere, so I appreciate that a lot. That actually is a very useful perspective for me, and I'll try to do better if you use it. The second thing, so I'm a member of the Open Air Collective, but there's something called the Climate Movement Challenge. We talked about giving more people and more sort of acceptance of carbon removal in society moving forward to help things. What would you want to see on the next generation of the people in college now, the people who are studying now, the university students? What should they focus on if they want to advance this industry and make it more successful?
Great question. And clearly, you are part of our solution broadly for all of us here. What should you focus on?
I mean, this is probably the youngest person that's on the Liberty Conference. I had a really nice visit, it was a field trip actually to the Bay Area a couple of weeks ago, where we sort of visited a lot of these brand new startups. And when I say startup, I mean most of their materials were, you know, pizza ovens that they bought on Amazon and sort of wearing pitch filters that they use as capturing units. And really, you know, what I saw there, and it was in the backyard of these sort of industrial parks with a garage band and, you know, a bunch of people sort of focused on how can they make their capture process more efficient. There was also one that focused on producing bio-oil from corn stalks. You know, this type of innovation, that this is necessary, is the same as what happened in the tech industry, you know, 15, 20 years ago, before 20 years ago as well. And a lot of these people who I met, never thought that they were going to work on climate. I mean, climate is definitely an issue. It affects young people, I think, in terms of politically what engages more. And I think there's definitely not a shortage of university graduates who are leaving college these days who want to work on climate. They just don't know how can I actually participate in this. And very much coming at it from what can I do with my degree, how can I be climate beneficial and get involved in industry, and of course make a living from it. But I think also, you know, the days are sort of ending where sole focus of students and graduates is very much how much money they can make, but it's actually how much impact they can have on the world around them. And I think that's definitely the shining light for me. It made me very motivated actually seeing this, because, you know, these people have managed to reduce their, you know, how much process heat they needed in their units, how much costs they estimated from the capture units. Now, providing the real innovation, what we're seeing, where, you know, first stage companies and the
remiss of me if I don't make the case for traditional engineering. So mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, civil engineers, it sometimes escapes people in the general public just how big an engineering challenge this is. These are big plants, there's a lot of mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, et cetera, et cetera, that's going on in this. And of course we need to continue the skill sets that have been developed in terms of subsurface engineering and geologists and geoscientists. That's going to be critical as well.
Yeah, one of the venture capitalists that I follow, I think, had a quote recently that said, you know, this is not going, climate is not going to be solved by an app, right? It's going to take at scale work in the physical environment to get us where we want to be. Great conversation. Thank you for your data point as well. This is exactly the dialogue we want. I know we got a lot of questions. We've got about another 25 minutes left, so keep this coming. Next question, please.
Yeah, my name is Holger Gell. I'm with the German Institute for International Security and IPCC legal work on the global body mark on processing. The remarkable litigation with Jarad, I would agree with you that idea, and I think, first of all, it should be called emissions reduction in Jarad, because CPR is litigation, there's also some other going on at social summit today. And it's received in many forms. Even if you look at government estimates of energy productivity developments, there's also some kind of emissions reduction in Jarad, because they put fantasy numbers in there to avoid hard emissions. So I think it's good to get into the details of how to avoid it. My question also refers to what Eli said in the beginning. Is it really useful to distinguish between engineer, non-engineer, or engineer versus natural, or maybe is it not about the time scale of storage that matters?
Yeah, that's a great question. How do you know, thoughts on differentiating between natural and engineer? From my perspective, you know, differentiating between short-lived or short-term and permanent storage and reduction is an interesting way to frame it. I'd love to hear what our panelists.
Before I attempt to answer that, I wanted to do a quick plug, actually, for a very exciting report that Dr. Eden and some co-authors will be releasing. Is that okay to mention this? Yeah, so Carbon Gap is a funder of this as well, but it's a report called State of CDR. So it will attempt to consolidate what is the state of CDR in terms of public acceptance on social media, policy, funding, status in integrated assessment models, everything you can dream of. So keep an eye on carbonremovals.org, which is the web platform that collects all the carbon removal content from COP. And we'll have an announcement there on that platform, carbonremovals.org, to see the state of CDR, which will hopefully become a recurring report year after year to show that this is a legitimate sub-pillar of mitigation. On the engineered nature distinction, we find, and we've seen this in a lot of places, it's useful to say that the full chain carbon removal method has three parts: extraction from air, conversion into a storable format, and storage. And any of those three steps can involve engineering, or can involve natural processes, or the enhancement of those natural processes with engineering. So I fully agree with Oliver and you, Jarad, that it's about the durability of the storage. We try not to say permanent, because permanent is a sort of binary distinction, which is almost impossible to achieve. What we have is lower risk storage and higher risk storage. So the way we look at it at Carbon Gap is we say, for every type of carbon storage, you're relying on two things to keep that carbon safely stored. Number one, the biogeochemical characteristics of the stored carbon. How, on a physical basis, how safely, or how much does that carbon resist being re-released to the atmosphere? Two, legal and social constructs. Our whole government and policy and legal world that can hold somebody liable if something goes wrong. So that's the kind of non-technical soft side of how we keep carbon stored in the ground. So some carbon removal methods, like soil carbon sequestration, are going to rely more heavily on the second one, the sort of legal and financial and insurance constructs that keep that carbon stored, and a little bit less on the physical security because, frankly, the active carbon cycle is just a lot more active. Whereas something like direct air capture with carbon storage, DAX, you're going to rely very, very heavily, and you'll be happy to be doing so, on that physical high durability character of the storage. You still need those legal mechanisms. You still need to be able to point to a carbon steward and say, that entity is responsible if anything goes wrong. But you won't have to worry that much about that, because the immobilization is going to go quickly and then eventually it'll mineralize. So I think it's useful to have those two types of storage security in your mind, and to think in terms of lower durability and higher durability. They're not better or worse, they're just descriptors of different
especially those working in the CCS space, not because they don't agree with the fact that it's confusing to label things natural and engineered because there are so many things in between and it really depends on what exactly is being done. But the problem is in the communication. I have not figured out a single way to tell people, you know, we have different types of removals. It's just so easy to say, well, you know, there is the biosphere and then there are these engineered approaches. It's much more difficult to already go down to explain. Like, I would love to talk about just like hydrability, but somehow it just doesn't have that ring when you use it in the communication, and that's why even I fully support that we shouldn't really be using or making this kind of dichotomy of natural and engineered. I just end up keep doing it myself and going against my own beliefs because I have not figured out a better way of talking about it. And if some of you have, let me know because I'd be happy to change my ways.
Communicating a really complex topic simply and effectively and succinctly and well, right, is extremely challenging. We all need to find ways to work together to do that well. And again, if anybody has any ideas, I think, you know, we'd love to hear, certainly on behalf of the Global CCS Institute, that's a conversation I would love to have with any of you every single day of the week. We've got a number of hands up still. Ruth, please go to the front so you can get a good snapshot of who we have questions on. We've got about 15, 20 minutes left. Hopefully we'll be able to get all your questions. Please go ahead.
Hi, I'm a student at Duke University, but I'm also interested in local climate action, especially in my hometown of Boston. And I'd like to hear you guys talk about the policy side of this complex solution. But I want to hear about like specific policy action that you guys can support, especially at the local level. And I know that like, the common answer is that it depends on the context, it depends like, on the country that you're in. So maybe I'll narrow the scope of that question to the U.S., maybe specifically to urban local governments. What specific policy actions do you guys recommend that they take just for CDR development?
All right, let's do this lightning round and go down the row, and then we'll get to the next question. Policy recommendation, local level, United States.
I'm going to do a big plug for the Open Air Collective, and you can meet with them just after. They'll find you. The Open Air Collective, we're members. Most of us are members of the Open Air. Everyone's a member of the Open Air Collective. It's a grassroots movement to really say to everyone, you're a policymaker. Literally anyone who has some enthusiasm for this topic, it's possible to contribute. In terms of a specific idea, it is location specific, but you know, I think it's just about looking around you and looking for lovers. So it could be something as simple as, your university procures a lot of food. Where do they get their food? Do they get their food from farms that are organic or non-organic? What if we extend that to carbon? When we say there are carbon farms, as the European Union would like us to think, this idea of carbon farming certification, which we're exploring with the commission and everyone. And maybe you have a rule which says you know, you get your university to buy a minimum percentage of their food from farms that are practicing regenerative agriculture. That's just a random idea, but the point is, I think, to demystify it. What you're really doing is you're looking out at the world and you're saying, where are the levers and where are the instances where people are buying money and moving carbon from one place to another? I guarantee you, wherever that's happening, there's an opportunity to put a rule in place, to put an incentive in. And it can be at the local level. I think Open Air Collective has been really involved in something called the Four Corners Initiative, which basically is bringing local municipalities, so city governments in the U.S., to band together and actually aggregate their demand for carbon removal so they can have a sort of single platform for that. We're even looking at extending that into the U.K. There's some really interesting towns that are receiving money for the CCS clusters. So these are kind of somewhat economically deprived regions of the U.K. with mayors who have big aspirations to level up their community. What if they could contribute and join in these efforts? So I think there's a lot to do, and certainly at Carbon Gap, we're really excited to support that. But I think Open Air Collective is our dear partner in that effort.
Other quick thoughts? All right. More conversation afterwards. Next question.
What do you need to know to
has to come back to public policy. We have to public policy makers. We have to make that determination. As a plant developer selling credits, you know, we have to get revenue to be able to support the construction of these plants. So our focus is on hard to abate industries, and they're the ones that are coming forward. But you're not making a determination on behalf of society as to whether or not they're truly hard to abate. It's very, very difficult for us to do that. But we would support the efforts made by policymakers to try to define that. They can't really define it any better than that. From our standpoint, we have to stand up a revenue stack to support the plant development. By the time it gets to 2050 and we've got gigatons of CO2 being pulled out of the atmosphere, then my hope is that will be much clearer, there'll be a much clearer answer so that it isn't being used as a way of defraying emissions that could have been affected by them.
Really good meaning to go in that direction. So So what would be this added value that is overall completely changing around the chips would you bring?
Great challenge. I don't think we have to change around any of the official UN infrastructure, although Kenya is proposing that, I believe, to do some edits. The reason to do it is about creating legitimacy. It's about creating space for people to recognize removals as an organizing principle. It's relatively recently, and it's really just the past few COPs and since the 1.5 report, that we, even if in the early 2000s there was already this distinction of regression removals, that even the COP, the climate sort of engaged crowd wasn't really thinking of planting trees, rewetting peatlands, and building machines to take CO2 out of the air as under the same bucket. So I think it's really about inspiring and creating a space for a legitimate discussion. So it may be possible to have a campaign that is reduce, remove, adapt, or that actually gets inspiration. I think you would know better than anyone I know which elements of the UNFCCC infrastructure we should not touch, and which ones maybe Kenya can find a way to create that attention. So it's really about accelerating action and moving faster. It's not about correcting any issue with, I think, the existing division.
Yeah, and it's interesting, you know, we've got a lot of motion supported and accelerated by government policy, such as great examples in North America. And I think from my perspective, the net zero framing has certainly increased interest in conversation in this overall topic. And so this is a wonderful discussion. In the interest of time, let's go to the next question for our panelists.
Tim Wright in the Australian Industry Group. Policy makers are effectively, by default, running up a high degree of reliance in the future on removals and net emissions. Mostly not, I think, through any form of moral hazard, but through a lack of clear thinking about carbon budgets. Are there any, given that we need to make both physical preparations and financial provision for the scale of renewables that we will need, are there tools available for policymakers to integrate those future needs into their thinking now about emissions targets and about budgets, like fiscal budget provision for future needs that are being run up ever further, would be a great thing to have now, rather than either a sort of conspiracy of silence of policymakers not wanting to annoy the moral hazard people by talking about CDR, or just sort of arm waving about, well, a lot of things will have to happen. So are there specific tools for making the sort of estimates of what will be needed and translating that back to impacts on decision making now?
Do sufficient policy tools exist to accelerate and enable deployment of CDR? And if you see any gaps in the opinions on those in terms of policy perspective?
Well, I can try to take a stab at that. I think that the starting point will have to be, first of all, the country will need to figure out how far it reduces emissions, like how far will it get, and how much will it need to scale up removals, because that's, you know, the basic information that these decisions, the next decision will be based on. And then, like, how to fund it. But I think it's quite difficult to put in place tools where you foresee funding for a long time in the future, just because the way the politics works, right? It's just very, very difficult. I'm really happy when it can happen in practice, but often it cannot. For now, I think it's just useful to make the plan how the scale-up should take place. And we already have some very useful tools in terms of funding policies in place in different countries. Like, we have the tax rates in the US, we have the EU looking at the funding, almost for the innovation fund, we should be scaled up. We have the Norway doing the reverse auctions. Like, there are different tools and different best practices that are emerging more and more. So basically learning from those examples as well, and then using them how they fit to your specific national or policy landscape.
Yeah, I think further to what Emma said, I think firstly, the best policy is one that can be implemented, right? So it really depends on the economy of what jurisdiction we're talking about. I think there's imperfections with 45Q, maybe it's mentioned as a policy incentive for carbon storage, right, for point source capture.
capture for direct air capture. There's just different dollar amounts. It's $85 a ton if you take the point source, it's $185 a ton if you get direct air capture, and it's required that you have to store it permanently in say, in storage. There's limits to that. You know, there's technologies which probably should be included but aren't, and they need to find a separate policy. There's stuff in there that probably shouldn't be included. Throw recovery capture, for example, there's a benefit for 45Q. 45Q was implemented because of the political environment in which it was designed, right? If 50% of the population in the United States tend to question whether we should, you know, take aggressive action on climate, but, you know, have favorable opinions about building infrastructure and what's needed to sustain clean energy on a broader level, that's what was implemented in the United States. I think in Europe we might be able to take more aggressive action in terms of designing better policies than 45Q. But the advantage of 45Q is that it gets projects off the ground. Julio talked about the stuff that excites him the most, and really what excites us the most as well, is to see large-scale open access pipeline infrastructure, large-scale storage sites. These storage sites are going to be open, these pipelines are going to be built, and they're going to be around for several decades. And, you know, now they might be taking emissions from fertilizer plants, from cement plants, and those are going to be needed to reach net zero and beyond, for sure. But, you know, other aspects of the power sector might play a role in those in the early term. But then as we move towards getting to fully net zero and towards net negative, direct air capture is going to play a huge role, and those same infrastructure is going to be needed then. So very much we need to think about what is politically feasible and then what do we need to achieve that particular goal. That's great.
Excellent. Great conversation. I want to be respectful of everybody's time. We're going to have one question from the gentleman with the microphone and one question from the gentleman in the row in front of you. The panelists are going to answer. We're going to reserve a minute and a half or 2 minutes for 30-second final thoughts from our panelists, and we'll get out of here on time. So succinct question, please.
Yes, hi. My name is Ben Carter of the University. So you talked about the importance of public acceptability on this. Obviously, when it comes to moral hazard, to diminish returns, there's a big question with how we use our removal. So I'm wondering if you can reflect on the role of enhanced oil recovery as a pathway for scaling CDR.
Question one is the role of EOR, and question two, specifically?
Sure, it's actually a build on the previous question around financing. It was quite helpful. So John mentioned I was stuck for the energy company, and we're involved in the Pathways Alliance, which has an ambition for a 10 megaton storage by 2030. And what I want to build on is maybe for C, and there's obviously two components of the financial equation that we're trying to deal with here, the upfront capital and the ongoing operating costs. And we talked a little bit about some of the policy tools that are there. What would you say are some of the keys to those financial equations, both from an upfront capital and ongoing operating cost perspective?
Right, let's answer that second question first, Greg, just leave succinctly thoughts on EOR, and then we'll go final thoughts for the others.
Yeah, the energy policy, in terms of the operating cost, the key component is energy. These are very high energy consuming projects. So you've got to address the question about surplus or additionality of the zero emissions power that we're using. So we're very reliant on that as something that is going to support the decline in costs over time. And we'll do our part in terms of developing and improving the efficiency modifying the process, redesigning generation by generation to take advantage of the efficiencies, but clearly energy costs need to be part of the equation. We've got a pretty good understanding of what the breakdown is between capital, operating, maintenance, energy, water, and so on. So I think from our perspective, we've got a pretty good line of sight to how we get that cost, that total levelized cost of capture down to sort of commodity range in the $125 to $250 a ton range. But the energy cost piece is really important. And then, if I may, just a quick comment on the EOR. We've been very open about two things. One is that we gain our experience and our expertise has come from decades of operating the EOR project. So there's no... We've built up this understanding of how to manage carbon by using that process. And our CEO has been very clear that there is a conversation we have here about the mathematics of low carbon intensity fuels. We talked about sustainable aviation fuel earlier, where where you take the green hydrogen and you combine it with atmospherically sourced CO2 in order to be able to get a drop in fuel. There is an alternative of using CO2 in an enhanced oil recovery project where you're sequestering more CO2 in the process of the EOR, and it's going to be emitted as a scope 3 emission when that barrel is converted into a fuel. So mathematically, it's as good as or better than a sustainable aviation fuel. So that is there as an alternative.
So answer the question if you want, and then we're going to go lightning round in terms of final last thoughts and 10 or 15 seconds.
I think the EOR aspect is very important. I think it's certainly something that we need to answer because it's played a large role in the carbon capture, right? The points of capture as well as direct air capture. Ultimately, my opinion on EOR is that it's a policy failure. If the market is designed through policy mechanisms to make EOR feasible versus permanent storage, then policy is failed. Right? Ultimately, that's we can recognize the importance of enhanced oil recovery for the past several decades in the United States in accelerating capture technologies. I think this capture side of things would not have happened were it not for the enhanced oil recovery industry being built. However, the sort of amendments that were made to 45Q in 2018 and the recent amendments to the Inflation Reduction Act have now sort of led entities who are involved in enhanced oil recovery for several decades to shift their business models towards a permanent storage provider. And that's ultimately dictated by the policy. I think actors like 1.5, like other players in the space, they will go where the money goes. And ultimately, when it comes to carbon removal, the policy has to be designed to make sure that money goes to the most effective place, and that place is permanent storage. So that's my
and from my perspective, to get to the gigaton scale in durable permanent storage, it needs to be safe storage at that level. There are a few other markets, EOR is one of them, but it would be all of it to our design. Final thoughts, 15-second last thought. Avard, Eve, Eli Mitchell, Steve, let's do this all in under a minute. Start.
Like I said, infrastructure. We need storage sites, we need lots of them, we need pipelines, we need as much as we can do to try and harness the synergies between point source capture and carbon removal. We focus on that aspect and design policies that can be implemented. Politics is always the most important part of this. That's the way we actually achieve both emissions reductions and removals. It's the best way, I think, avoiding the moral hazard of focusing purely on removals. I think we can actually do very well to harness both sides of the coin.
Yes, so let's keep working on that capacity building. There are still plenty of those around who don't know their removals from their CCS. But in parallel, I think we have arrived at the point where we have enough knowledge and we've done enough knowledge building to start putting in place good specific policies to scale up removals. So it's time, it's been done.
I would appeal to the need for, since we're at COP, multilateral cooperation. So carbon gap focuses on the European member states and the European Union and the non-member states, but if you hear about carbon removal projects in Kenya, we see Octavia, this new DAC company popping up there. We need to be cooperating on standards. We need to be cooperating on best practices for policies. So get in touch. Carbon removal is probably the most global, borderless set of solutions within climate change more broadly. So let's take the energy from COP, stay in contact, and actually start building this industry and this movement together.
The last point for me is this is no longer a future technology. We are building this now at scale, at climate relevant scale. We just need help in defining and making sure that we've got all of the certification, verification in place so we can satisfy our customers that what they're buying is a durable product that's valued.
Great. Thank you all for your time and attention participation today. Please join me in a round of applause for our panelists.